Please turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. The history of the Lord Jesus Christ, part 1. And by the grace of God, we will be here for a while. We're not in a hurry. And we should never be in a hurry when we're talking about Jesus Christ, other than to be in a hurry to tell somebody about him. The History of Jesus Christ, Part 1. The Just Jesus Evangelistic Campaign, day number 8 for this year. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1, the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Holy Father God, we praise you and we thank you for your holy word. And Lord, help us to preach from a passage that most people skip over. And one of the reasons why they skip over it is because they can't pronounce the names. But Lord, help all of us to realize how important this passage is. Only by the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord God in heaven, we are weak and feeble, and we need your spiritual, mental, and physical strength. We pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Have mercy and grace upon each and every one of us. And Lord, for Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us of our sins, failures, and faults. Crush and crucify our flesh and the old man within us. And fill us afresh and anew with the fullness and the power, the unction and the anointing of your Holy Spirit. Grant us the unction of your Holy Spirit, for we cannot function without unction. Grant me clarity of thought and clarity of speech. And Lord, we pray that you would rebuke and bind the devil, his demons, and his hosts. Lord, from this time together, here and around the world, and we pray that you would open blinded eyes and unstop deaf ears and save those who are lost as we preach on the history of Jesus Christ. Just Jesus. And no one else and nothing else. And we pray that you would surround us with the banner of your holy angels and rebuke and bind the devil, the spirit of the devil, the demons of hell, the spirit of Judas, Lord, from this place, that your holy word would go forth freely and clearly, that others may come to know your Savior before it is eternally too late. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, and for his sake, amen.
No.
No. Bear with us. Thank you for your patience. The History of Jesus Christ, Part 1, The Just Jesus Evangelistic Campaign, Day Number 8. Ladies and gentlemen, after preaching the gospel by the grace of God every day for 367 days straight, throughout the 2016 presidential campaign season, that 367 includes January the 1st, which landed on a Sunday. By the grace of God, I am preaching the gospel every day throughout the first 100 days of our new president's term, President Donald Trump. If you think a new president being placed in office is the only thing needed to save America and make America great again, you are woefully deceived. The Church of the Lord Jesus Christ must follow through and keep the main thing, that is reaching unbelievers with the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ and praying for their salvation. For the problem in America is not only disobedient presidents, disobedient politicians, and disobedient people, secular people, people who don't believe, and but rather disobedient pastors, disobedient preachers, and disobedient parishioners in the church who have refused to obey the Lord's Great Commission, which is to go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. I have a preacher friend who has a Reaching Creatures Conference. His emphasis is reaching all people, is what he's trying to say. Black, white, red, and yellow, whoever needs to hear the gospel and be saved. And who have refused to obey God's repeated commands to pray without ceasing for unbelievers, believers, and political leaders. So we encourage you to pray for the new president, but not to get caught up in the political happenings like the world does. For nothing much is going to change until people get saved and get their hearts right with the Lord. America needs to repent. We don't just need a new president, we need a new heart and a new mind and a right spirit. And so therefore, ladies and gentlemen, that is what this campaign is all about. the Just Jesus Evangelistic Campaign. All about Him, not about us. It's all about Him. This campaign is inspired by the following three verses from the Word of God and other verses. But these three particularly. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 2, which says, "For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified." Acts 5:42, which says, "And daily in the temple and in every house they ceased not to teach and preach Jesus Christ." And 2 Timothy 2:4, which says, "No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." Beloved, this series is not for Christians necessarily. However, I do hope you are one of those saints who still loves to hear the old, old story of Jesus and His love. And as another hymn says, "For those who know it best seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest." And this series is primarily for unbelievers, for people who don't know Jesus Christ as Savior, so they can hear and understand the gospel and be saved from sin and the punishment of sin, which is hell. This is message number 8 in this new series. Earl W. Crawford said, "The Christian faith is firmly rooted in the incarnation, in the conviction that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto Himself. To believe in Christ is to believe that God has come to earth to dwell with men. In Jesus we meet the living God, Emmanuel, God with us. Jesus is more than a religious genius or a holy man or a spiritual leader or pioneer. To believe in Christ Jesus is to believe that the living God has come." End of quote. Amen, somebody. Beloved, the man Christ Jesus was born into a society, into a world and culture that put great value on one's family and lineage. You must understand this. And I really want you to get this. And because of that, by the grace of God, we're going to be here a while. I want you to really get a hold of the foundation of the history of the Lord Jesus Christ. Where one came from was more important than where one was at the present moment. In those days, you were considered a nobody if you could not say, "My parents were so-and-so, and my grandparents were so-and-so, and my great-grandparents were so-and-so." God help you if you were born to an unmarried woman and did not know who your father was and who your folks were. Even today, though, particularly in my generation, we wanted to know, who are your folks? Where are you from? So this is not far-fetched. And particularly in this instance, what is important is whether or not regarding Jesus Christ, is He from the royal lineage? And so, just like with royalty in England, they trace it back for years to make sure that you're the one who's supposed to sit on the throne. And by the grace of God, in future days, by the grace of God, I will be sharing more details about that. Out of all of the Gospels, Matthew was written primarily for a Jewish audience. Thus, the author was aware of his readers' expectations, and he begins the gospel with a genealogy, the book of the generations of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. He also sprinkles throughout his opening chapters a number of references to Old Testament prophecies. In fact, the Bible Knowledge Commentary states that Matthew includes approximately 50 direct citations from the Old Testament. In addition, about 75 allusions are made to Old Testament events. Matthew knew that his people would not accept Jesus Christ on his name alone. They would ask, who is his father? What tribe does he belong to? If he is truly the Messiah, does he fulfill the Old Testament prophecies? Matthew begins answering these questions from the start. As we look at Jesus' genealogy, we see that it is traced all the way back to Abraham, the father of the Jewish race, and the father of all who have faith in God, according to the Apostle Paul. It is significant that Jesus is a descendant of Abraham, because God told Abraham, in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. During the first century, the Jews were expecting a Messiah, a savior for their nation alone. But God planned to bless all nations through the coming Messiah. Amen, somebody. His name is Jesus. Dr. John Walford and Dr. Roy is up, men gifted to be theologians in our modern day. And everybody's not gifted to sit in a stuffy office with a bunch of books and do nothing, Danae, but study and dig and dig and get something from it and breaks it down for people to be a blessing. I thank God for Dallas Theological Seminary and other theological seminaries that produce books for the saints to grab a hold of and get something from. These two brothers collaborated on a major commentary. I don't think it is as poetic as Matthew Henry's, but I think that they're right up there, scholarly speaking. Anyway, they said Jesus came with a message for his own nation. But in the plan of God, his message was rejected. Therefore, a universal message reached out to the entire world. The promise of blessings for all the nations of the world came through Abraham and the covenant God made with him. Somebody who is spiritual ought to say amen right now. It is significant, beloved, that Matthew did include Gentiles, such as the Magi from the east, the centurion with the great faith, and the Canaanite woman who had greater faith than Christ had seen in all Israel. Also, the book concludes with the great commission to go and make disciples of all nations. In fact, that is the passage most quoted for the church today, to get out of their pews and to tell others about Jesus. Jesus' family lineage traced through his earthly father, Joseph, going all the way back to Abraham, is presented to us at the outset of this wonderful gospel. By the way, by the grace of God, throughout the entire year of 2016, I preached through the Gospel of John. And so if you did not hear that series, I would encourage you to tap into it at our site, Gospel Light Society, or Gospel Light House of Prayer. It's all over the internet. And God will bless your heart. And if you're not saved, you can be saved. Luke presents another lineage for Jesus, traced according to many scholars through his mother Mary, going all the way back to Adam and to God himself. Every time I read that passage, my heart is so blessed. The significant point that we take away from the record of Jesus' family history is that Jesus became a man, a flesh and blood human being, God in the flesh, Emmanuel, God with us. He joined the human family so that we one day might join his family, the family of God. He became a son of David and a son of Abraham so that we might one day become the sons and daughters of God. Can somebody say amen? Beloved, someone once wrote, "I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod. I am a part of the family of God. From the door of an orphanage to the house of the king, no longer an outcast, a new song I sing. From rags unto riches, from the weak to the strong, I'm not worthy to be here, but praise God, I belong." And you too can belong, ladies and gentlemen, to the family of God as well, by placing your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and his finished work on the cross for you and for me, for this Jesus who was born so many years ago as a baby, through the power of the Holy Spirit, without the help of a man, through the Virgin Mary, came to die on the cross for your sins and for mine as the Lamb of God who has taken away the sins of the world. He shed his blood for your sins and for mine so that we can be saved by simply believing on him. First, dear friend, accept the fact that you are a sinner and that you have broken God's laws. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Second, accept the fact that there is a penalty for sin. The Bible states in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death." We die physically because of sin. We die spiritually because of sin and go to hell. Jesus Christ, thirdly, spoke more on hell and preached more on hell than he did about heaven. Jesus Christ said in Matthew 10:28, "And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul. Rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." Hell is an awful place, but Jesus came and died on the cross to save you from hell. That's why I believe he preached more on hell, to warn everybody to believe on him. Jesus Christ also said the good news in John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish where in hell, but have everlasting life." Believe in your heart in the Lord Jesus Christ. Believe that he died for your sins, was buried, and rose again, and he'll save you today. The Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Are you willing to pray right now and ask Jesus Christ to save your soul, believing in your heart that Jesus Christ died for you, was buried, and rose again? If so, follow me in prayer, phrase by phrase, and mean it from your heart. Holy Father God, I pray in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I acknowledge that I am a sinner. For Jesus Christ's sake, please forgive me of my sins. As I now believe with all of my heart that Jesus Christ died for me, was buried, and rose again. Lord Jesus, please come into my heart and save my soul and change my life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Help me to repent of my sins and to follow you in the new life. In Jesus Christ's name I pray, and for his sake. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, if you believed in your heart that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, was buried, and rose again, allow me to say congratulations to you on trusting Christ as your Savior. You've done the most important thing in life, and that is simply believing on the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. For more information to help you grow in your newfound faith in Christ, please go to gospellightsociety.com and read my pamphlet, What to Do After You Enter Through the Door. For Jesus Christ said in John 10:9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. Dear friend, if you trusted Christ as Savior today, please email me at dw3@gospellightsociety.com and let us know. We have some free material that we want to send to you immediately. And if you have a prayer request, please email that to us as well, and we will pray for you until you tell us to stop. Dear friend, until next time, God loves you, we love you, and may God bless you real good is my prayer. Let's all stand for our closing prayer. Now, just now, save you, Jesus will save you, just now. Cut it off. Holy Father God, we praise you and we thank you for your goodness, your mercy, your love, and your grace. And we thank you, Lord, for the message today. And we thank you for, most of all, your Holy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, your Holy Spirit, and your Holy Word, and for all of the millions and manifold blessings you bestowed upon us. And Holy Father God, for Jesus Christ's sake, Lord, save every soul who heard this message. We pray, and every soul that will hear it, have your Holy Spirit's conviction to fall down upon them. And Lord, we pray that millions will hear the gospel, millions will come to know you as Savior. I do believe with all of my heart that you will answer that prayer, and I thank you in advance for doing so, for your glory, praise, and honor, for the lifting up of your Holy Son, Jesus Christ, and for the many who are in danger of going to hell. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, and for his sake, amen. Until next time, my beloved, may God bless you and keep you, is my prayer.